Well, congratulations on BAFTA and everything. What was your reaction when you found out that all this was going on?
Well, I was thrilled. I felt like everything just happened so fast. You know, I just started working in this industry for a few years, well, 3 years really. And wow, I'm so grateful that I received the support that, you know, that I asked for. It's, you know, I look forward to meeting the mentor. I don't know. When I first found out that I was one of the recipients, I was like, it was a really good week. It was great to be back on set working, and it's great to get this news.
Yeah, absolutely. It is a huge deal. And I can imagine. I mean, has it changed much of your well, I say your life, your career, or anything else? But has it changed you in any way just yet, or are you still kind of reeling from the shock of it all?
Well, I think I feel like this is becoming more and more real, and more information that I'm getting about the program, who the other award, you know, winners, the recipients are. I look at all that. I just feel so proud and surprised, pleasantly surprised about the diversity of this cohort. Really, I'm just so used to being the only one, so to speak, with a disability who's deaf, but that's not the case this year. I mean, it's amazing to see. There's a lot of people of color, people who are differently abled, women, and you know, it's all are part of this consideration for this program, and I think that is thrilling to see.
Yeah, and also I was going to mention about there seems to be a change, but a change with a purpose this time, rather than people just talking about it. There seems to be a proper change happening in the industry. That must be great to be part of that and know that it seems as if it hopefully will be permanent, and that we won't have to talk about it because it will be part of the norm, as it should be.
That's exactly true. And in a way, I think that the pandemic really had a lot to do with that. I think that we had to stay inside. It took a lot more time for us to actually be introspective and really, you know, unpack things that we've been doing. And also many of us, you know, have watched so much TV and film right now, because what else are we supposed to do during the lockdown, you know, binging so many different stories. And, you know, people just naturally want to feel that need of connecting with other people. And I think now we've found that connection in different unexpected ways, which is more valued now.
Absolutely. I wanted to ask you about,
now that the industry is starting to realize that people really are becoming very seasoned and participating in the whole story, you know, within the whole storytelling, watching so many different TV shows, series, films, that I think that the viewers nowadays are expecting a lot more, and they want to see more of themselves when they're actually watching TV. So I think that, you know, the industry recognizes that now, and there's a need for more realism, really, and more representation.
Absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely. TV should look more like the real world, basically.
Yes, indeed. Absolutely. So I remember seeing you in Wonderstruck, and that was a film that was a fantastic story, but also had Millicent and yourself part of it. And it was a great story, and the celebration of, as you said before, people of from all walks of life, you know, and everything else. I just wondered what that experience was like, being on a film, not just being on a film set, but being part of that particular story, because it meant a lot to the people involved and also to the people that have watched it.
Well, I have a lot to actually say about that film, Wonderstruck. It just shows that, you know, representation, well, I'm trying to figure out how to even say that. Everything, it's not just about black and white. There's a lot of gray in terms of support, collaboration, and allyship. You know, I don't know if you were aware, but Wonderstruck was a big deal. And the reason being is because they cast, you know, a deaf actor to be the lead. And that was a breakthrough role for her, really. Mm-hmm. And with Millie, Millicent Simmons. And I think at the same time, also, they cast a hearing actor to play a deaf person, a deaf role, which was Julianne Moore. And at that time, it actually caused a lot of upheaval. And I think Julianne, you know, had a conversation about that. And I felt like when we actually met, well, let me explain a little bit more. She actually came to my house in Brooklyn to visit and just to meet a deaf family. I really wanted to get that insight of what it feels like to interact with a completely deaf family and who just lives their lives just fine. And you can see from her questions and her thought process, she really put a lot of thought into the role. And it wasn't something she was just taking lightly. I mean, look at her previous roles. She plays very complicated, challenging roles. Just like, you know, Alice, the woman with, you know, Alzheimer's, you know, amazing. So I feel like people like Julianne, who really respect the craft of acting, who really look at acting as a way to actually become someone else, walk in their footsteps, you know, to really actually understand and respect their lives, their perspectives. So I warned Julianne, I was like, this, you know, you will experience some backlash from the deaf community by doing this role, because basically, you know, it's equivalent of blackface, basically. So, but then again, I've actually learned that within the industry, it's also complicated. You know, oftentimes you have to bring in people's attention. You actually have to do it with the bigger name stars who actually have that star power. Mm. And that person in this case was Julianne Moore. And she has star power. Obviously, people know who she is. She brings in an audience. So I felt like she, when she played this deaf character, she did it with a lot of respect and caution. And moving forward, I felt like she actually had become a true ally for the deaf community. So I feel like that in a way, you know, we lost a potential other deaf actor to be in that role, but we also gained a life living ally. So sometimes things are gray, they're just not black or white. And, you know, just to show support for marginalized people.
Is that also true? Would you say that's also true of Riz in, obviously you've done The Sound of Metal with him, which is a performance that a lot of people are talking about. I'm really excited to see him and do that because he's one of those actors that really likes to challenge himself. So I just wondered whether you would say that was the same of him, because he is someone that really throws himself into a role regardless of what the performance entails. He wants to tackle it head on and do the best job he possibly can.
Yeah, I think Riz Ahmed is another great example of that. You know, of an actor who really understands and respects the craft of storytelling. And he himself, you know, comes from a marginalized community. So I think he has that sensibility and understanding. And he's also very aware of the power of his role and what he's doing. And I just felt like Riz, you know, was amazing. And I feel like this movie really was a passion project by Darius Martyr. I just really applaud him, I have to say, because there are some areas where they could have had thought a little bit more about how to support the deaf community. But right now, I just feel like The Sound of Metal is one of the most authentic looks at the spectrum that you would see in the deaf community. You see a person with hearing loss who's grieving about that loss of losing something, all the way to the other end when you meet the other characters in the story who have always been deaf. And that's just a part of who they are. There's nothing that they felt like they needed to overcome, so to speak. And I think that was lovely to see.
Yeah, I look forward to seeing him in that role and that film, because there's a lot of people talking about it, which is very exciting and you're part of. So that's even more exciting. You're also part of one of those big movies that you can't talk about, but I'm going to ask you about it anyway, because people are so excited. We've had a year of no Marvel movies, and for many people, that's, you know, they're having the one that itch that, you know, scratch that itch, as it were, because they're waiting so long. What was your experience like on your first day when you went to the set of Eternals, and was it overwhelming, or did you feel you were part of a family from the beginning?
Well, I'm still processing the whole thing. I have to say that whole Marvel experience, we're still not done with it. So you know, I'm dying to believe that, you know, I have to wait a whole other year before it comes out. It's torture, I have to say. But I have to wait a whole year from the very first time I heard that there were rumors, maybe interests of me playing one of their superheroes. And I was like, is this for real? I had to wait a whole year before it was actually confirmed. Then now we look at a whole other year before it actually is released. The wait. But one thing that I am very grateful for is that the director, Chloe, she had the cast, you know, because not everybody was selected at that time, but as many of the cast members come together just to have a brief, you know, table read or interact and get that sense of who we were and how we interacted. And that's the first time we actually met was at Comic-Con, really, when we were in San Diego Comic-Con. And that was so overwhelming. As here I am looking at all these people who are part of the MCU, who I watched growing up, and now all of a sudden we're in the same room. I was taken back, but I actually am more thrilled than overwhelmed about being given the opportunity to represent the deaf community. I'm very thrilled about that, just to, you know, bring in that storyline within the MCU. I think, you know, there's plenty of room for more stories like that.
Yeah, and you talk about the family. I mean, this is a very, very big family. The cast is exceptional. And you have at the top of it, obviously, as with yourself, someone like Angelina Jolie, who isn't just a movie star. She is an ambassador, and she is someone that wants to help to try to make a change. I mean, what was it like meeting her and kind of discussing things with her? Because that must have been a great thrill because of all the other stuff that she does, as well as just being a movie star.
Well, Angie, I have to say, she is, you know, both such, she's gentle and strong. I was so grateful and appreciative to have her there with us because I feel like she really is very aware of, you know, what our needs might be. She always, you know, she's always thinking about the cast. She would ask questions that a lot of us were wondering, and she's the one who'd step forward and ask those questions. So, you know, Angie was so much help and so warm, so warm. I mean, we've had wonderful conversations, and I will tell you one short story where I was struggling with trying to figure out a cue for a specific scene, and I just couldn't see some of the director giving me the cue. So it was a little awkward, and through conversations with Angie, she helped figure out the best way that we could make that scene work. And I mean, Angie just, you know, she has such a big heart because she's willing to share her experiences with us. I really like her.
Most people say that. I did interview her last year, actually, at a premiere, which was very nerve-wracking, but also very thrilling at the same time. So we share that, I guess.
Right, that's exactly it. And also her son actually learned American Sign Language. So I thought that was great.
Oh, fantastic. Fantastic. So for you, obviously you've now done a big movie. What's kind of your aspirations going forward? Are you looking to help get more awareness, get more representation in movies and in television, and also for yourself as an actor? Is there some aspirations that you have going forward?
Yeah, to be honest, you know, as I said before, I feel like everything is happening so fast. You know, it's just been 3 years and here I am. And it's not like I haven't had an opportunity to really delve in any specific mediums from, you know, whether it's Broadway, TV, film. I've just jumped and it's been so rapid. It's been a blessing, don't get me wrong, but I'm still processing it. And I'm still trying to find what my footing is here in this industry. And how can I help? Of course, I do want to make a difference. And I know that I'm already, you know, representing different people, multiracial communities, different cultures, the deaf community. Of course, I'm aware of that, but I want to do more. So now I'm just starting to really see that there is a lack of authenticity in stories about deaf lives. And I want to see more of that. I want to see different in different genres, whether it's a comedy, romantic comedy, drama. And I just feel like, you know, moving forward, I'm going to be really interested in developing more of those stories. Yeah.
Absolutely. Well, I hope you get the opportunity to do so. Thank you so much for your time. Congratulations on BAFTA and everything. And fingers crossed, this time next year when Eternals comes out, you guys might be able to actually come to London to promote the film, and we will hopefully meet again.
Fingers crossed. Here's hoping.
Here's hoping.
It was such a pleasure chatting with you.
Ladies and gentlemen, you're watching Hey You Guys!
Hey You Guys, huh?
Hey You Guys,
is that from The Goonies?
It is indeed, yes.
Nice.
Hey